Okay. In the last lecture, we started to discuss at first the fluid mechanics. We will later on go into heat transfer of turbulent flow. And as an example, we selected to look at turbulent flow through a tube. So I'll just repeat very briefly some of the things which we had discussed in the last lecture. We consider flow through a tube at a sufficiently high Reynolds number so that the flow is turbulent, sufficiently away from the entrance so that we have developed flow. And we said that under this situation, we have, if we measure with an instrument with large inertia, so that we measure only time averaged velocities, we find that the streamlines obtained in this way are just parallel to the axis of the tube. Or we can say there are surfaces, cylindrical surfaces around the axis, concentric around the axis of the tube, and the effect of viscosity is to generate a shear stress, if it would be laminar flow, a shear stress between these various layers. If we have turbulent flow, then in addition, we have the fact that only in a time average picture, the fluid particle runs in this way. In reality, if one would look at it with a finer instrument which can resolve the situation in time, there are continuous fluctuations around these surfaces. And this turbulent transport then generates an additional shear stress, which we call a turbulent shear stress. Now, we know that for the laminar shear stress, we can write for sufficiently high Reynolds number flow the equation tau is mu times dv over dy, where v is the velocity, if we are interested, for instance, in the shear in a certain surface here, then we have to consider the velocity in this surface. And y is the distance, the direction normal to the streamlines. So that this means a change of the velocity measured in the direction normal to the flow per unit length, normal to the flow. We wrote this also in the way rho times kinematic viscosity times dv over dy. And this is a shear stress which is already exerted in laminar flow. Now, in turbulent flow, we have in addition this turbulent mixing, and we express it by a turbulent shear stress, which we write just in analogy to the laminar shear stress, equal rho times a quantity epsilon, turbulent diffusivity, again times dv over dy. Now, whereas the kinematic viscosity is a property of the liquid, so we can look it up in reference books as soon as we know what liquid we are using. The epsilon is not a property, but depends on flow conditions. We have seen, for instance, that it depends very strongly on the radial location. It is quite small out here, actually it is zero at the wall, and then it increases and drops off again towards a small value in the center. Just to refresh the memory, we have also seen that in the bulk of the fluid, at reasonably large Reynolds numbers, beyond the critical Reynolds numbers, the epsilon is quite large compared to the nu, maybe 100 times as large as compared to the nu. Only at the wall, since the epsilon goes to zero, we have a thin region where both are of equal magnitude. And this, of course, then means always we can transfer to the shear stresses. So in the bulk of the fluid at reasonably large Reynolds numbers, the turbulent shear stresses are very large compared to the laminar ones, only near the wall. They are of equal order of magnitude. Now, the total shear which is exerted on a certain surface in the fluid then is just the sum of these two shear stresses. And of course, as soon as we know the shear stresses, we can, in principle, again, as we did in our course in fluid mechanics, apply Newton's law to a properly selected control volume in the fluid, and in this way then get a quantitative answer on our flow situation in the tube. Now, we want to assume, additionally, we want now to go to heat transfer, to a heat transfer situation. So we assume that by some means we heat the wall of the tube to a certain temperature, T sub W, maybe by electric heating or by any other means. And in this way, then, we create a heat flow from the tube wall into the interior of the, into the fluid which flows through the tube. Then we have physically the following picture that, again, at, provided that the Reynolds number, this means the flow velocities, for instance, are large enough, that heat is transferred from one stream tube to the other stream tube by conduction in laminar flow. Now, in turbulent flow, it is additionally transported again through this turbulent mixing movement. Heat is then also transported in flow direction within each stream tube by convection, by bulk convection of the fluid as it moves through the corresponding stream tube. Now, if we again call the heat flux, which moves through a arbitrarily selected surface here, per unit area, per unit time, Q, lowercase q, as we did it always, then again, we can say in turbulent flow we have two processes contributing to heat flux. One is the heat flux by laminar conduction, and the second by conduction alone, and the second one is heat flux by turbulent mixing. Now, heat flux by conduction must be given by Fourier's equation, so we can write this is minus k times dt over dy. If now T is the temperature at this place, and again dt is a variation of temperature in the direction normal to the flow per unit change in this location, in the radial location. Again, we can write the equation in a somewhat different form by remembering that we had before already used a physical property which we called the thermal diffusivity, which was defined as alpha equal K thermal conductivity divided by the density and divided by the specific heat for gases at constant pressure. In this way, then, we can write this here is equal to minus rho C sub P times alpha times dT dy. And again, now to, and this would be just in laminar flow already existing. Then in turbulent flow, we have an additional way in which energy can be transported, and we will call the heat flux by the heat transport by these turbulent mixing motions QT. And again, in order to be able to, let's say, to have an expression for the turbulent heat flux, we write an equation for the turbulent heat flux in a form analogous to this one, where we simply now replace the alpha by, again, a term which would be a turbulent diffusivity, but this time for the thermal transport, so I will put a subscript T on. And again, multiplied by the temperature gradient. And of course, in this moment, we haven't done anything. We have only shifted our lack of knowledge from the QT into the epsilon t. In order to do something with this equation, we have to know something about the epsilon t, and this as, can again only come really from experimentation, in the same way as here. If we want to use this equation here to express a turbulent shear, we have to know something about the epsilon, and this again we can just get from experimentation. Now, one from the evaluation of experiments, one finds that the variation of the epsilon t over the cross-section, over the in radial direction in the tube, and also then with Reynolds number, we found that the epsilon also depends on Reynolds number. That the variation of epsilon t is quite similar to the variation of epsilon. So that suggests we always, it is good to have in our equation some values which are constant, or at least approximately constant, so that suggests to consider now the ratio epsilon over epsilon t. And check experimentally how this ratio now changes in a flow. And one finds that there is, actually it is quite difficult to measure any of these quantities exactly, and especially this ratio exactly. So the experimental information which we have is not very exact. But as far as we can, I mean this one, I think we can say that the variation of this quantity, either locally in our flow field or with Reynolds number, is comparatively small. It might be a variation in the range from 0.7, 0.8 to 1 or somewhat above 1. So that this is a nice behavior of this ratio, which is useful in any kind of analysis of turbulent heat transfer. Actually, if we look at the laminar counterpart of this ratio, this was the epsilon which describes the turbulent shear to the epsilon t which describes the turbulent heat flux. If we build the same ratio for the laminar shear to the laminar heat flux, then we see the corresponding ratio is nu over nu over alpha here. We have then the same parameters in front of the values. And the value nu over alpha is called the Prandtl number. It's a dimensionless property of the fluid, the Prandtl number. And from this analogy, then one calls this ratio turbulent Prandtl number. And since it has been found experimentally that the turbulent Prandtl number doesn't change very much, it suggests itself to get to a simplified analysis by forgetting about this variation and assuming that this turbulent Prandtl number is constant in our flow field. Actually, and making analysis based on this assumption turns out results which agree quite well with experimental information. Actually, it was found even that if one sets this ratio simply equal to 1, turbulent Prandtl number equal to 1, gives already quite good results. So this is often the basis of analyses in turbulent heat transfer. Actually, I will show very soon that setting the turbulent Prandtl number equal to 1 is actually a procedure which goes back a long time. Osborne Reynolds already proposed this. And therefore, this assumption, turbulent Prandtl number equal to 1, is today referred to as Reynolds analysis. Now, actually, Reynolds got to this, not introducing this form of the equation, got to a statement which would correspond to this statement that the turbulent Prandtl number is equal to 1 by considering a simplifying picture of the actual turbulent process. And we will do this now to even simplifying, but following essentially then the ideas which Osborne Reynolds had, because I think this gives some kind of understanding of how the turbulent transport acts and promotes heat transfer. Well, maybe I will need this still, so let's go on here. Now, we can, as we mentioned, consider the turbulent transport through an arbitrary plane, which we put in here parallel to the flow direction, that continuously fluid particles are by these turbulent movements moved from one stream tube into the neighboring stream tube and vice versa. In this way, they will transport with them in their movement for a certain distance because of their, for instance, thermal capacity, the energy which they have stored, or their temperature. So in this way, temperature or energy corresponding to the temperature, heat corresponding to the temperature in this stream tube will be transported over to the other stream tube, and vice versa. And this obviously must lead to a energy exchange or to a transport of heat. In the same way, momentum, each, let's say, a fluid particle as it is moved from by this turbulent mixing from one stream tube into the other stream tube will, again, because of its inertia, for some time carry along the momentum corresponding to the velocity which it had. You remember that momentum is defined as mass times velocity. And this is actually, in some sense, goes into Newton's equation, can be put into Newton's equation. So this momentum will again be carried along from by the mass of the fluid as it moves from one stream tube into the other stream tube. For instance, if the velocity here is smaller than here, then the fluid particle as it moves into the other stream tube will arrive with a velocity which is smaller than the rest of the fluid in this stream tube has, and will therefore exert a decelerating effect, and vice versa if a mass of fluid moves into the other stream tube. So this will have the effect that the two velocities have the tendency to equalize. The same thing what happens if a shear, laminar shear, acts between the two stream tubes. So we want now, based on this observation, we want to create a simplified picture of this turbulent exchange from which we can get some quantitative information. I will, for this purpose, draw once more now this surface through which we consider our transport of masses caused by turbulence. And we have to assume, so that we get an effect, that the velocities vary in the direction normal to the surface. So for instance, this would be, this curve would give the velocities. And let's say there is a certain mass of fluid, m, or m dot, which moves per unit time from this location here up to another location, let's say to this location, and only it maintains its velocity, its temperature, up to this point, and then here it mixes with the rest of the fluid, it loses its identity. Then if the velocity in this plane from which this mass comes is v, and if the velocity in the, then the momentum transported with this fluid mass in its way upward is m dot times v. Now, there will, and there has to be from continuity, obviously, if fluid mass moves up, then there must be a corresponding transport of fluid mass down. And if we, now in reality, all sorts of masses coming from various distances move up and end at various distances, lose their identities in various distances from our imaginary surface through which we consider the transport, we will simplify, in a simplified way, assume that all the mass comes from one plane and moves into another plane, namely into this plane where the velocity is v dash. Then really continuity requires that the same mass flow which moves upward will move downward. So we can say there will be a mass of the same magnitude, m dot, which per unit time now moves down, but that, let's say, moves through a unity surface area of this plane downward. And this mass will now carry along its momentum m dot times v dash in the downward movement. So that we have a momentum transport m dot v upwards, a momentum transport m dot v dash downward. So we have a net transflow of momentum through this plane, which is just equal to the difference, which would be m dot times, well, however we want to write it, v dash minus v. This is then some agreement on the signs which we use. And this is now a momentum transport per unit time, because this, we said, should indicate a mass per unit time, through a unity cross-sectional area. Now, momentum transport per unit time is equivalent to a force. Momentum transport per unit time, per unit area, is equivalent to a stress. And as we have seen before, the stress which is created or is equivalent to this momentum transport is a stress which would act within the plane, so it is a shear stress. So we can say this expression, if we have this simplified picture of our turbulent movement, gives us the turbulent shear stress, which acts here in this plane. Now, if we have a temperature difference, say we have now temperature variation, if we plot again temperatures, then this would be in this plane T dash, and in this lower plane T, then as a consequence of this transport of mass, also energy will be transported, and as a consequence, there will be a change in the temperature situation. For instance, if the temperature T, as I showed it, is smaller than the temperature T dash, then this mass comes up with an internal energy, heat content, which is smaller than the heat content which an equivalent mass has in this plane. So it tends to cool down the upper fluid. In the same way, if this mass moves down with a temperature which is higher, then it tends to heat up the fluid which moves along here in this lower plane. So that, again, the consequence will be a decrease of the tendency to decrease the temperature difference. And this is the same effect which we have also in laminar flow as a consequence of conduction. So that, again, we can say, well, first let us express. So we will have a flow of energy, of heat, caused by the, or transport caused by the movement of the mass in an upward direction, and we get this by multiplying the mass with the specific heat. This then gives us a heat capacity, and multiplying this with the temperature T. So this is a heat flux which moves in an upward direction as a consequence of the turbulent exchange. In the same way, C, and again for gases, we have to write Cp, the P, specific heat at constant pressure, times m dot times T dash moves down. So that we have these two heat fluxes, and this means again there is a net heat flux caused by this movement, which is the difference between these two heat fluxes, and this would be C sub P times m dot times T minus T dash. Now, the fact that I write here T minus, or let's better write it maybe T dash minus T, but then if I want to get the right sign of the heat flux which is caused by this turbulent transport, I have to put a minus sign on. This doesn't really mean anything profound. It just comes from the way in which we define shear stresses and heat fluxes. Now, we cannot still not do much with these equations again. We might from measurements know these temperatures in these two planes, but we surely have little way to determine the mass. flux which is exchanged. But we can do the following. We can eliminate the mass flux out of these two equations by dividing one by the other. Let's divide the lower one by the upper one. So we get qt over tau t is equal to minus c sub p times t dash minus t over v dash minus v. Now, of course, in our simplified picture, again, we really don't know anything about this distance which a fluid particle travels before it's in an average, before it loses its identity. So as an approximation, we can say instead of using this temperature difference, let's just use instead the temperature gradient, the variation of the velocity within this plane per unit length. This means instead of putting in finite differences, we use infinitely small, very small differences, dt over dv. And then the practical usefulness of this equation is the following. If by some experiments we know the turbulent shear in a tube, then we can, from this equation now, since these are only time-averaged values, we can calculate the turbulent heat flux. Now, let's see, and this is again, let's say this is the answer essentially which Osborne-Reynolds obtained. Now, Osborne, one can do this in a more extensive way by actually considering mass fluxes coming of various planes and going into various planes and summing up. But one ends up with this equation if one assumes that the same mass which transports momentum transports also heat. Now, and I will now show that this is equal to the situation which we have here, Prandtl turbulent equal 1. Well, to show this, we just have to divide the two expressions which we had before for the turbulent heat flux and for the turbulent shear stress. Let's do this. Then we get from here the turbulent heat flux divided by the turbulent shear stress is equal to minus, the rho drops out, c sub p times epsilon turbulent over epsilon laminar, epsilon thermal over epsilon for the velocity field for the transport of momentum, and then multiplied by dt over dv. So dy drops out. And we see that this equation is identical with this equation, provided this ratio, which is the turbulent Prandtl number, is equal to 1. So really both, let's say, this statement is equivalent to this statement here. I mentioned that in reality, one finds experimentally that this ratio is not quite equal to 1. And it also varies somewhat locally in a flow field. This obviously means that the basic assumption that the same masses which transport momentum transport also temperature, and let's say over the same distance always, that this is not quite correct. One reason for this is that we have often, let's say, turbulence is characteristically has vorticity, and this changes the situation with regard to the, can change with regard to the momentum transport over certain distances. Okay, now the question is, of course, then how do we use this in a practical sense? Now, we mentioned before that our measurements of the epsilon over the radius of the tube has indicated that we have a inner part of the bulk of the fluid where the turbulent transport is an important one. Actually, it is so large in most cases that the laminar transport can be neglected relative to the turbulent transport. But then we have a region close to the wall where both are of equal order of magnitude, and both have to be considered. In order to see, let's say, to get this picture clearer, we have already here the ratio of turbulent transport of heat to turbulent shear. And as I mentioned, this would be the dominating mode of transport in the turbulent part. Let's just see what is the corresponding ratio for the laminar transport quantities. So we will write the ratio Q laminar over tau laminar. That is equal to, if we take this the second term, and here also the second term, then the rho drops out, we have again minus C sub P times alpha over epsilon, laminar over laminar, so alpha over nu times dt over d. So, and this means now in this layer close to the wall, the ratio of laminar transport of heat to shear is described by an equation which is somewhat different from the ratio of the transport in the turbulent region. But if we ask the following, we will find that the situation becomes especially simple if the Prandtl number is equal to 1. Now, this is not the turbulent Prandtl number, but the laminar Prandtl number, the property of the fluid. This means if we consider a fluid which has a Prandtl number equal to 1. Let's just recall that gases, for instance, are quite close to this condition. So that this would be a good approximation for a gas. Well, the laminar Prandtl number is defined as, if we recall, the ratio of nu kinematic viscosity to thermal diffusivity. If this is 1, this means this ratio here is equal to 1. And we see then, under these situations, the equation describing this ratio of transport quantities by laminar action is described by exactly the same equation as for turbulent transport. This means we have really now the same mechanism which causes the transport, as far as this ratio is concerned, in the bulk of the tube and in the void. The next thing which we can do is we have to look now at how does the heat flux and the shear change throughout the cross-section of the tube or over the radius of the tube. We have found already the last time that the shear varies in the following way. It increases just linearly from the value 0 at the tube axis to the value which the shear at the wall has. So that would be the tau, where I again, consider this as a diagram where I plot the shear stresses in this direction. Now, measurements of the heat flux. How does the heat flux vary through various surfaces at various radial distances? The experiments show that the heat flux variation is the following.
The heat flux is zero through the axis. It increases first almost linearly, but it goes through a maximum and it drops off at the wall.
But again, if one wants to simplify the analysis, one can say, well, the variation, the difference between the variation of the heat flux and the variation of the shear is not so large, so that an analysis which neglects this difference may already give quite good answers, and one finds that introducing actually this variation changes the results of an analysis very little. Then, if this is the case, then we can say the ratio of heat flux to shear at any radius is the same as the ratio of heat flux to shear at the wall. So that this ratio, and for Prandtl number one, since these two equations are the same, this is also for the total heat flux, which would be just the sum of turbulent and laminar heat flux divided by the sum of turbulent and laminar shear, is constant and is equal to the corresponding ratio at the wall. It's independent of radius. So this is independent of radius. Then the CP, of course, is independent of radius. If we forget about the variation of the specific heat, which might occur, for instance, as a consequence of the temperature, which is normally small. And this means the ratio dT over dV is constant over the radius of the tube. And this, with other words, implies that the temperature profile is similar in shape to the velocity profile. So that for such a Prandtl number, I have then the situation that if this would be, for instance, a velocity profile, we know that in turbulent flows, a velocity profile looks something like this, with very steep gradients near the wall and a comparative flat profile in the center. And if we have the situation that, for instance, the wall temperature is larger than the temperature in the center, we would get a temperature profile which would look like this here, where, let's say, the temperatures are measured, for instance, from this plane, from this line. Where the velocities are measured from here. Now, what we mean by similarity of the profiles is the following, that if we look at the velocity at this distance, at an arbitrary radial distance, and the corresponding temperature difference, T wall minus T, at this distance, and the corresponding values at another distance, where the velocity is, let's say, V dash, and the corresponding temperature difference is T wall dash minus T dash, that the ratio of V over V dash is equal to T wall minus T divided by T wall minus T dash. And this must obviously follow from this, because if the gradient, the ratio of the two gradients at any location is a constant, then this must lead to the similarity of the two profiles in this form. So this already is an interesting fact that for a Prandtl number one, this means with good approximation for gases, we have to expect that the temperature profile is similar in shape to the velocity profile. Now, with this, and then with the simplification that the ratio of heat flux to shear is constant over the cross section, we can then easily get an equation from which we finally can calculate, for instance, what is the heat flux from the wall into a fluid, provided we know the corresponding temperature conditions and the corresponding velocities. if we use this equation, we might just as well use this equation. It has the same form if the Prandtl number is equal to 1. Then, and we said that this ratio is equal, is the same as the ratio of the corresponding quantities at the wall surface, at the wall of the tube. So this means we can write Q wall over tau wall is equal to minus C sub P. I leave the minus sign off. I will take care of this in a minute. Now, if the two profiles are similar in shape, then obviously we can take any temperature difference at corresponding distances. We must always come to the same value. This is really expressed by this equation. So I can take any characteristic temperature difference. Well, one which is useful is that I take, for instance, the difference between the temperature of the wall surface and the bulk temperature, which is average done in a proper way over the cross section. So, I write T wall minus T bulk temperature. Now, for the velocity, I have now to take the corresponding values. To the bulk temperature corresponds here for the velocity profile, the mean velocity, Vm. To the wall temperature corresponds the velocity 0. So in the denominator, I just have to put in the mean velocity. And the minus sign, you see, since I have taken here the mean velocity minus the wall value, I should have taken bulk temperature minus wall temperature. Now, by turning this around, I have already got rid of the minus sign. Okay? So, then I have this equation. Now, if I have a relationship which describes a wall shear, then I'm all set. I mean, if I have a task in which I have the wall temperature prescribed, the average fluid temperature prescribed, and the velocity, the mean velocity, which I get from the volume flow through the tube prescribed, then as soon as I know the shear, I can calculate the wall heat flux. Now, in order to get an expression for the shear, we would have to go back to our lecture in fluid mechanics. We have there found that, as always in fluid mechanics, or in heat transfer, or really in any kind of problem on continuum mechanics, it is always very useful to calculate with dimensionless properties. So instead of saying something about the shear, one introduces again a dimensionless property, or we introduced a dimensionless property which describes the shear. And this is called the friction factor. And I will write it in this way to be in agreement with our notes in fluid mechanics. F divided by 4 times rho Vm squared over 2. We can easily check that the dimension of this quantity is equal to the dimension of rho Vm square. So that the F is actually a dimensionless parameter. And for the F, one finds from experiments, this is equal to 0.316 divided by the Reynolds number to the power 1/4. So all we have to do now is to introduce and this here into our equation. Let's say take the shear over to the other side, and we get the Q sub ball is equal to, let's say, the shear, which is then rho Vm square 1BM cancels out, and then there's a CP. So it is rho, and I leave, will put in the constant, rho CP BM. Then the numerical constant is 0.316 divided by 8, which is 0.0386, I think. No, 396. And then I have this 1 over Reynolds to the power 1/4, which I also can write times Reynolds to the power minus 1/4. And then I still have the temperature difference, T vol minus TP. Now, on the other hand, as always in convective heat transfer, it is convenient to calculate with heat transfer coefficients. This means to define a heat transfer coefficient by the equation Q vol is equal to a heat transfer coefficient times, pardon? Oh, yeah, thank you. Should be Reynolds. Thank you. Multiplying with a temperature difference, and for tube flow, this is the temperature difference, which is conventionally used. And then you see that the heat transfer is just this expression without the temperature difference. And again, we try to make this, put this into a dimensionless form, which we obviously can do by bringing this product over to the other side. So to write H over rho C sub PVM. And it can be easily checked that this can be already expressed with the dimensionless parameters which we have introduced, namely Nusselt number divided by Reynolds number and Brunton number. And then this is equal to 0.0396 times Reynolds to the power minus 1/4. Yeah, and in this way we have really now an equation which describes us the Nusselt number as a function of the two parameters which are determining for forced flow, Reynolds Brundtl number. We have to keep in mind, of course, that this is really for, this equation holds only for Brundtl number equal 1. So we can just as well set Brundtl number equal to 1. And if we then finally solve for the Nusselt number, then we have the equation Nusselt is equal 0.396 times Reynolds to the power 3/4. For this, we have to keep in mind, for a fluid with a Brundtl number equal to 1. And it turns out that this equation, which we obtained by our simplified model, or if you want to, with other words, by applying Reynolds analogy, making the turbulent Brundtl number equal to 1, it is found that this is in very good agreement with experiments. So it describes, for instance, the heat transfer for flow of gases through such a tube quite well. Not, let's say, one deviation is, of course, always still that gases do not quite have a Brundtl number equal to 1. So then the next point is really now to see, well, this was a special situation. If we have water, oil, some fluids like this, we know that we can have Brundtl numbers which are quite different from 1. And the question is how to proceed in this way. Well, obviously, we don't have to do very much more. We have to, again, introduce a, if we want to stay in a, let's say, with a very, with a comparatively simple calculation. Then we have still to introduce another simplification, and this is the following. Let's recall once more. Maybe I draw here in this flow picture through the tube a curve which would indicate the variation of the epsilon over the cross section, and you recall that it looks something like this. The epsilon is has smaller values in the center, it goes to quite large values, and then it drops off to zero at the wall. And depending on the Reynolds number, we could also put in the kinematic viscosity. This might have a value like this. Now, the simplification, which then was introduced in order to extend this calculation to Prandtl numbers different from 1, and the complication comes now in by the fact that now the laminar transport is described by an equation different from the one describing turbulent transport. That one simplifies now this situation in the following way by, again, saying, well, we have the bulk of the fluid where the turbulent shear described by the epsilon is much larger than the laminar shear described by the nu, by the parameter nu, so large that we can forget about the laminar contribution. We say here, just the turbulence is effective, the laminar contributions can be neglected. But then, instead, as we have in reality a region where both are of the same order of magnitude, one says in this simplification that I consider now a thin region close to the wall where the turbulent shear is negligible compared to the laminar shear. So instead of having this transition where both are of equal order of magnitude, where at the wall itself the turbulent shear goes to zero, so there the laminar shear is overwhelming, we replace this by an imaginary layer in which the flow is just laminar, turbulent has completely disappeared, and in which then this equation alone describes the energy, the ratio of the two fluxes. And this is of course a simplification, but we will see that in this way we can very quickly get from the calculation for Prandtl number 1 equal to a calculation holding for any Prandtl number. All we have to do is now to subdivide our whole flow field into two zones, the central region, for this we use this equation, and the border region, for which we use this equation. Now, I don't think that I will talk about the show, demonstrate the calculations the next time, but I will just in general mention that this simplification then leads to an equation which turns out to be quite good and give quite good results for a moderate range of Prandtl numbers. Let's say it's a Prandtl number for fluids with a Prandtl number maybe up to, depending on the accuracy which one asks for, 10 to maybe 100. For very large Prandtl numbers, it doesn't work very well. So the reason is that we have simplified conditions here in the neighborhood of the wall considerably. Now, of course, we can just as well, if one wants to do, let's say, more extensive analysis, we can replace this simplification here to introduce a laminar layer. And by the way, this has been introduced for the first time by Ludwig Prandtl and has been called by him the laminar sublayer, which is below the turbulent flow at the wall, by where one considers now both of the shears, turbulent plus laminar shear, in this layer, and then one has to introduce proper values for the turbulent epsilon. And this is really how, analytical results for turbulent flow went in recent time. One can get improvements in the final relations, which one gets by such an analysis, but at the cost of more and more work, more and more effort, which one has to put in. always, in all of these assumptions, it's always necessary to put in experimental data. For instance, one has to put in something which one can get only from experiments up to now on this exchange property epsilon, if one wants to be very exactly also on this ratio epsilon over epsilon t on the turbulent Prandtl number. There's of course a completely different approach to turbulence, where one actually tries to start out with the equations which describe unsteady fluctuating flow, now saying, if I would be able to solve these equations for unsteady fluctuating flow, one should really be able to describe how these fluctuations at any time, if I know it at the beginning, at the beginning of the time count, or let's say at the entrance of the tube. But even the electronic computers which we have today are not able to do this. In addition, one really does not know with such detail in general the entrance conditions in such a tube. The other possibility is to say, well, I'm not interested usually into knowing exactly all the values as they fluctuate in time and in location. I am satisfied with statistical averages. So somehow I apply statistics now to these equations and try to come up with some answers in this way. And there is work continuously being done to try to analyze turbulent flow by application of statistical methods. But up to now, progress is not so far that one can go into practical flow situations like flow through a tube or a boundary layer flow, and from statistical calculations, for instance, get now analytical values on these parameters which we have introduced. Yeah, I think at this point I want to close today. And I say what I want to do the next time then is to get with the simplest model which we can have, which puts in here a laminar sublayer. And something which I want to mention in this connection is that recently one has tried to measure now actually the fluctuating quantity by hot wire instruments. And moving with the hot wire instruments towards the wall, one has found that the fluctuations really never die down. They become smaller as one approaches the wall. But as close as one could get to the wall with these instruments, one still had fluctuations. So in this way, the term laminar sublayer has got somewhat into discredit. Recently, one talks now more about a viscous layer here, because it's still not a laminar steady flow in a strict sense. Yeah.